You don't even know what exam it is. Expecting that you're going to do well in the exams? Biochemistry. Do you know biochemistry? Yeah. Okay. What about trigonometry? You know trigonometry? Yeah, good. But there might be a subject that you don't even know. Quantum physics, maybe. I don't know much about it. Yeah. And I cannot expect that I'm going to do good well in quantum mechanics. I didn't even know it was an exam for quantum mechanics. I would not expect to pass. And at the end of the day, I would say, look, that's okay, that's life. No, it would be a foolish of me to not to prepare for the exams if that was indeed an exam which is so important. If this life is created by God and God has given us a reason to know Him, to submit and surrender to Him, to love Him, and to look after the creation. And then I didn't know any of that. Instead, I just followed my wishes and my desires and my whims. And I did whatever I wanted to do. I followed my whims. And I was a bad person in the sense that, if someone said that, I have power and wealth and I have means to do that. So I'm going to take you, your land, your family, your business and everything, because that makes me happy. Or I'm going to take your wife and your sister as my, you know, sexual pleasure, because I have the means to do that. I'm going to exploit the family. I'm going to destroy London if I want to, if I had the power, because I don't like Londoners. Some people do that. You see, they have crazy mentality of what? The selfish need, they have this greed. Brazilian drug lords, for example, you know what they do. Yeah? So, and then I live like a king and I die like a king. Where is the justice?
But how then, where did that start? Like that they became evil and those kind of things?
Very good question. When God created us, He gave us the free will so that we can choose between the good and the bad, and He showed us the good and the bad. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. He inspired within us, you know, the good and the bad. Yeah? And Allah says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Successful is the one who has purified himself or herself. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. And the one who is totally in loss is the one who is, you know, didn't do it well and didn't look after itself. So Allah says He has shown, inna hadaynahu sabila imma shakira wa imma kafura. He has shown you the two ways, the good and the bad. Whether you are grateful or ungrateful, look at the mercy of Allah, of God. Whether you are grateful or ungrateful doesn't matter. He has shown you the two ways. So if God has shown us the good and the bad, the ways that we should do and not do, then the accountability is going to be on our shoulders. We will be responsible.
If you're like born into, let's say, bad or poor environment, and your parents are criminal, and all your friends, and do you really stand a chance in life?
Yes. That is why God doesn't only leave people alone. He sends messengers. Prophets and messengers. And what do they do, prophets and messengers?
And what is their role? All of them, their duty is to convey the message of God. So if the people are lost, if they have misunderstanding or anything, they came to convey the message of God to them, to tell them this is good and this is bad. The good should increase the good deeds that you do, and you stay away from the evil deeds. So they came, even though. So Allah said in the Quran, لَكَيْ لَا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. So the people, they will have no, for example, no evidence against that in the day of judgment when Allah is, you know, bringing them the evidence. He will say, I have sent messengers, and there is a lot. And the final message of Allah is the Quran. So it's an eternal message of Allah, and it's still here, and it's still approachable by many people. And Allah told all of us to ponder upon the Quran. Then that's why Allah said in the Quran, in the beginning of the Quran, it is guidance for those who seeks piety. So if you are truthful, you want to find the truth, that the answers are in the Quran. That's how it's the eternal message of Allah.
Just like thought experiment, let's use your example from the Brazilian drugstore. Your example from the Brazilian drugstore, if you're born in this family or in a really bad Brazilian neighborhood like the favelas there, and you say like you send messages, but do you think these messages even reach those people there?
Okay. So there's two points to this question. Whether the true message of God reaches people to be accountable or not. And the other thing is, do people have access to this message? Okay. Today, by the virtue of information around the internet, World Wide Web, and other social media and so on, information is available at our fingertips. Okay. you don't have to go to a mosque to pick up a copy of the Quran. You can just have it on your phone and it's there in your language. Yeah? The Quran and its interpretation and its exegesis, the sayings of the Prophet, the Hadith, the books translated even in your languages, and the explanation of it.
Yeah.
It's very difficult not to be aware and be having access to the information. Okay, so that's one thing about the reality. But it may be true still, there are certain times and certain places people do not have access to this message. Now Allah says very clearly, He does not punish a nation, any nation, unless He sends them a guide, a warner. So if the message did not reach them, they would not be punished because they have not reached the message. This is from the mercy and justice of God. So in the past, where let's say some messengers were sent, but there are still the tribes, for some reason they haven't reached the message, they will not be punished. But one thing that God has given them though, which they should have used, if they haven't used this, they will be accountable. In one of the chapters in the Quran, Surah Al-Mulk, Allah talks about, there will be a group of people dragged by chains, by the angels of hellfire, to the hellfire. Because there is a place in afterlife, either heaven or hell. Yeah? Those who deserve to go to hellfire, they will go. Because God is merciful, He doesn't just put people in hellfire. From His justice, that they will go to hellfire. Those people who are dragged in the hellfire, they will be asked, "Alam yatikum nadhir?" Did they not come to you messengers, prophets, warners?
Really, completely different question. How do you value like the basic court system and justice system we have in like England, Western world? Because you say like the final judgment is your judgment day. That's when you get
But there are lots of opportunities beforehand for someone to reflect, mend their ways. So let me give you some examples. And just to finish this example about the Quran in Surah Al-Mulk. When those people are dragged and they were asked by the gatekeepers, the angels, did they not come to you any messengers, any warners? Alam yatikum nadhir? Did not come to you any warners? They will say, قَالُوا بَلَىٰ قَدْ جَاءَنَا نَذِيرٌ فَكَذَّبْنَا وَقُلْنَا مَا نَزَّلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. They said, yes, they came, but we belied them, we denied them, we rejected them. But then they will confess. So God is giving us information of the future. What the discussion that these people are having, they will then say, وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلْ لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. If we had listened to the prophets and messengers and warners, or, this is the key point, used our aql, the intellect, the intelligence, we would not have ended in this place. To give you an example of how the intellect is guided throughout constantly, but people miss the opportunity from their own self. Let's say a worshipper of an idol is worshipping an idol, concentrating, meditating. Okay, it's in front of him. He's made an idol with gold or whatever, right? A statue. A dog comes along, lifts, it's one of the left or right leg, hind legs, and urinates on the idol. The worshipper sees that and he gets angry. That God defiled my God, the dog defiled my God. He runs after the dog. As he's running, suddenly came to him his mind. What am I doing? My God couldn't even protect himself or herself from the defilement of a dog urinating. How can that be? How can I worship something which doesn't even have, you know? So suddenly it clicked. There's an inspiration suddenly given.
Yes.
This was the spark of guidance from God at that moment. If that person stopped and realized, yeah, that's it, I should stop and reflect now. What am I worshipping? This is not worthy of worship. That would have been guidance. So God, Allah tells us, He inspires people, gives guidance and shows various ways, maybe in your dreams and so on and so forth. In your daily life.
Daily things, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You have to then use your intellect that God has given you and then come back to the realization. That is why one of the things as Muslims do, this, it's like, say, the prescribed medicine that we take every day, five times a day, every day, is called the medicines of realization. We pray our obligatory prayers at least five times a day throughout the day. And in this prayer, we come, the moment we start initiating our prayer, one step closer and closer to reality, who we are, why we are here, and who is the one, our creator. So you say, Allahu Akbar. You say, Allah is the greatest. There's the great, no other greater being than God. You see, in a form, Allah is Akbar means He is the greater. There's the nothing supreme. Great. It's such that this, anything that you think is great, is greater than that. That means He is the greatest. And you start by saying, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise and all glory, all gratitude to God, the Lord of all the worlds, everything that exists. So you are coming back to the realization that who is the Lord? The one, and what is the Lord? The one who creates, guides and sustains. Yep. The Lord is the one who created you, guides you and sustains you. So you're saying all praise and thanks and glory for everything, that I'm still alive and breathing, I'm in good health, the Lord of the worlds. The next step you're saying, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is the one, God is the one who is most gracious, most merciful, the giver of mercy, the one who is source of mercy, the one who is most merciful. No one is merciful than Him. Why did you come to that realization? Because you thought, and you should understand, that God has given me all of this. It's not because God is obligated.
But do you, it's like an open question. I don't know how you think about it, but don't you think that, for example, Muslims and Christians are actually like quite similar in what they believe?
Yeah.
But they just have
very much similar. So what made us different is what we can just quickly discuss. But there is the source of all of these religions and religious ideas and concepts was God and His prophets and messengers. But mankind started tampering with this message. To give you an example how mankind tampers and for what reason. This country has license for alcohol in pubs, yeah, free license. And they have license for you to buy cigarettes if you pay the tax. Tax is given us fine. Okay. Now imagine now the country's lawmakers who are going to pass a law in the parliament, they all agreed that they are going to stop production and consumption of alcohol and smoking. And this is what they agreed and passed a law. What's going to happen to the public? Uproar, uprise. They will like it. They will want to overthrow the government. What? You're going to take away what we like? You know, what was enjoyment for us? It's going to be very difficult for the government to pass a law like that. And that's why they are failing to pass effective laws against smoking, for example. The only thing they're doing is, oh, smoking causes cancer. Picture of a cancerous lung or something. It doesn't stop people from smoking.
Is it allowed to smoke in pubs here?
They stop, okay. There are different measures. There are different measures, but it doesn't stop people from smoking.
No, but then don't you think in some way like that you should be able to choose yourself? I'm completely against smoking, don't get me wrong. But like if you...
People don't choose. People...
But then it's a lack of information maybe.
I won't say it's a lack of information.
Would you allow me to make some questions of my own afterwards?
I don't think it's a lack of information. The reason why... The cigarette pack gives us the information. It's not lack of comprehension either. It says smoking causes cancer. Smoking kills. So now take this packet of cigarettes and I start reading it and I understand it. So information is received, information is analyzed and comprehended, but yet I don't act on it. So there's something else going on. In Islam, there are other mechanisms how to stop it. When Allah says, stop, don't even approach alcohol, gambling and so on. Do you know in the very initial stages what happened? Because Arab society was drinking alcohol like their gallons, right? When this revelation came in a final form, they just opened up and broken all their barrels and containers. It was like, you know, overflowing like a river float on the grounds. That's how they described it. They were able to do that for other reasons, which science or lawmakers are not taking into account in consideration. But there's another discussion. So when this believer starts praying, just to finish with one more example maybe. So the reason why I'm saying God is merciful and beneficent, it's not because God is under obligation to provide me all of this, it's because He's merciful. He's merciful, not because He's obligated. And then I come to a stage, instead of another realization, Maliki Yawmiddin. He is the master and the owner and the king of the day of judgment. Yes, this is not just this life, there's a king of judgment. And now what am I going to do? The one who is the master and owner of the day of judgment, I say إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. You alone we worship and you alone we seek help and sustenance and for all our need. So we are now submitting and surrendering to Allah because we know no one can save us in the hereafter. Because God is the one who's going to judge us. He's the king, he's the judge, he's the master, the owner of the day of judgment. So this is how the believer comes close to realization throughout the day. So that this concept of being in reality keeps you in check. So imagine now you just prayed and then you're going about your lives. Something comes in your mind. Let me rob him. You realize, oh, I just prayed and there's the next prayer coming. How can I rob him? I have no right. This is a major sin to rob of something that I have no right. It's his property, his wealth. In fact, a law in an Islamic society will implement it, if it was implemented whole, that if I had no need for it and I stole that he hid something and protected it, my hand should be cut off. This is how grievous it is to violate the rights of others, to steal something from someone someone which has been protected like this from stealing. So my next prayer, thinking about the next prayer, because it's throughout the day, think, oh, I want to go and do something bad. Immediately will stop me thinking, I'm not going to do that. Because I just stood in front of God. Next time I'm going to stand in front of God, what am I going to say? So this realization makes someone in check throughout the day. So the Brazilian drug lord should have had this opportunity of self-reflection, whatever belief they have, like, look, what if it was my brother, someone is killing the way I'm killing? I'm murdering and oppressing and raping and all that thing. What if it was my sister, what if it was my mother? They need to have this self-realization. And trust me, people have this self-realization. Unless you're totally a psychopath, which is totally out of your mind, then of course, you know, you're beyond cure in that sense. You should be locked away because you're not right. But other people who are not this compulsive psychopath where they have means of reform, you can reform. And this is why you'll be now at a shock to realize the concept in Islam, there's a concept of jihad of the nafs. There is a political jihad to fight and to expand and to open up lands where people can go and see Islam, because otherwise Islam will be, you know, not presented to them. This is how it's been in the past. But this other concept of jihad is the struggle of your own against your own self to make you constantly better. Better so that you are better with him or her, or you, with your father, or your mother, with your brother, with your sister, with the animals, with the environment. Constant struggle of being better and better, making you so much that uplifting you to be a noble person. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is described as the one who is the uswatun hasana for us, the one who we can emulate as our perfect model. He showed us how to behave, how to be kind, how to be nice, how to be just, how to be interacting with others. So this is what we have to do. So I cannot just treat someone because he's black or he's white or he's fat or he's thin because he speaks another language. The Prophet said, none of that. There is no difference between a black and a white, or a white and a black, an Arab or a non-Arab, or vice versa. The only difference between us is the one who is more God-conscious, more pious. Yep. So I can say, MashaAllah, you know, very good that, you know, this brother or this sister, you know, is being very close to Allah. And I wish I was like that. But I cannot envy him because he's black, or demonize him, or chastise him, or put him down, or put her down because they are not of the same skin color, of the same language, or, you know, all these things that people go under, racism and so on. So Islam eliminated all of this. This is what you should expect from the religion of truth. There should be no room for this kind of racism and intolerance. If you don't want to believe in Islam, fine. That's up to you. That's up to you. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ Quran says to you, your religion, what you want to do. But the consequences is with you and your Lord in the hereafter. Yeah?
Yeah. I like your point. I agree with it.
So I would like to, I mean, because we've talked enough, we want to bore you with other things, but I hope some of the things I said, you should, and I request you to reflect on them. Reflect and say, look, you know, my heart and my soul searches the truth. If the truth is found in Islam, what is my obstacle? Why should I make an obstacle because the Prophet was an Arab? you know, why? Does that make me any better if you was an European or so on? No. God can send this message to anyone, to anywhere, with any language. He chose his final message to an area in Arabia, in the language of Arabic, which best suited the last message. And this is one of the things the Quran actually invites people to think and reflect, that if you think this Quran, this message, this book is not from God, then produce something like it, a challenge given to imitate the Quran. This is one of the main reasons of the divine authenticity argument of the Quran, that it is inimitable. But that's a discussion of another day, how and how objective it is. So this is a copy to you from our friends, a free copy.
Nice.
Please read and reflect. And if you have any questions, you can ask your Muslim friends, neighbors, or come back in Speaker's Corner and we can talk about it.
I have some in
there. Yeah. Yeah. And there's some other leaflets that people have given you. I mean, just very small, very brief. Do read about it.
What is this?
Some leaflets to talking about, this one is about the concept of God in Islam. So, describing to you who God is or what God is and so on.
The other side now?
Yeah.
I basically know the other side because
She is from the other side.
I wanted
side.
To learn
Don't
about
worry.
Their side.
The other side has always something else to say.
Of course.
Because it's mutable, it's changeable. Now, before I start to say anything, I want to tell you that I
take,
no pleasure.
And God guide us closer and closer to the truth.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Mansoor, right? Let me tell you something.
Before you start the discussion, may I ask, what's the discussion about? Because I haven't invited you, and neither have you invited me. What's the discussion?
You don't have to invite anybody.
Like you brought your homework
home.
Okay, but I need to know whether this is.
I need to know whether this is going to be an interesting discussion. I need to tell you something. I assume that your faith comes from some traumatic experience in the past, and thus you are very linked personally to your faith. And I want to get something perfectly clear that this is not personal.
Okay.
What I'm about to say, what I'm about to argue with you, is not an attack against you. It's not an attack against your person.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because
so that's
what you told me, you had some traumatic things.
So that's the end of the discussion.
And I don't want to make fun of that.
No, that's
and I don't
no, no.
want to
so that's
make
the end
light
of the,
of
that's
that.
The end of the discussion. Let me shake your hands.
That's not the end of the discussion. That's
let
just
me tell
the
you,
introduction.
No, let me tell you why.
No, that's just the introduction. Now, let's get to the discussion.
One moment. Let me tell you why it's the end of the discussion.
Go ahead.
Because the moment you start discussing with me, you've already approached me with a bias and a false premise, false assumption. My religion, my belief, my faith is not based on any traumatic experience at all.
I didn't say it was based. I said it was linked.
That's what you said. It is no linkage whatsoever, no correlation whatsoever with any traumatic experience. So because you come with a baggage of bias and prejudice, I would say, you've come to speak to the wrong person. I think you need to clean your heart and start thinking differently. Maybe I should approach someone with a neutral ground.
No, I have to thank you for that.
So let's end the discussion.
No, let's not end it. But I have to thank you because
I
will not.
Anyone else interested to offload their baggage?
No, what I have to talk
thank
to you.
Thank you.
About our conversation the other day. And you may run away. Nice,
yes, I am.
You shouldn't. You really shouldn't.
Yeah, I run away from people with lots of baggages.
Here,
you know, loaded concepts.
Come back. Because I care about you as a person. I don't care about your
I'm sure
beliefs,
you do.
But I never want to hurt a person personally. I never like to do that. You can stop filming right at this
you
point.
Have a good night,
but you are just running from